Number one, because he's lost a step. But number two, most importantly and primarily, it's because he got ambushed. We can slice it any way we want to, but here's what it comes down to. Jerry Jones and the Dallas Cowboys threw Dez Bryant under the bus because of the manner in which they let him go. You have a receiver. He obviously is not what he used to be, Max, but clearly Dez Bryant is worthy of being on an NFL roster. So the fact that he's not on an NFL roster, it begs the question as to why that is, particularly when you consider how limited the Dallas Cowboys are at the wideout spot. You got Cole Beasley. Jason Witten is gone. Now Dez Bryant is gone. You got Terrence Williams. You got Cole Beasley. You got this kid Allen Hurns from Jacksonville last year and what have you. But you don't have stout playmakers, at least on paper. There's nobody that resonates with you that comes out front and center that makes you say, wow, the Dallas Cowboys are going to be okay. And so when you look at it from that perspective, I remember when I spoke to Deion Sanders on my radio show the day they let Dez Bryant go. He was like, they need to get him back. Why? Because who do you have? You have nobody. So that begs the question, why is he gone? Why is he gone? And ultimately, when they start asking questions like that about you, you're going to hear stuff. And what did we hear? We heard about protecting Dak Prescott. We heard about that quarterback having that locker room and not being, you know, flummoxed or overwhelmed by the presence of somebody else that's in his face demanding the football. We heard about those things. Then suddenly we heard about late practices and a lack of commitment or absence thereof. And then just as recently as yesterday, we heard tapes of Jerry Jones saying, well, he can play and, you know, I hope he's in shape. He almost caught himself because he was basically saying he didn't know what kind of shape Dez Bryant is in. Well, the man has been a part of your organization for years. You know what it was like for him during the offseason. You know what it was like for him in training camp. You've been around this man enough. You're the de facto coach, GM, and president of the team, for crying out loud. You know what Dez Bryant brings to the table. You know what his offseason regimen is like. So when you give those indications, you create all of these questions. Now, Dez Bryant did not help himself by speaking against Sean Lee, Travis Frederick, guys like that, because they ultimately came out and confirmed what our suspicions were. But those suspicions were initially alluded to by Jerry and Stephen Jones. And as a result, you have people looking at Dez Bryant and having question marks about his character as much as his game. I don't think that's fair, but that is the reality of Dez Bryant's situation right now.
The reason Dez Bryant has not signed with a team yet, or rather a team has not yet chosen to sign Dez Bryant, is because of the double D's, guys. That's right, the double D's.
Oh, Lord.
Decline and drama. That is what's going on
with
him.
That's what I think when I hear double D's.
I was getting ready to say,
we
all know I wasn't thinking that. Double D's is a different thing comes to my mind.
But I'm a serious-minded person, and apparently you're not. Yes,
can I go like this to you? Sorry.
Yes, please. Thank you. Uh-oh.
There you go.
What? Oh, no.
No, you're good.
Come on.
You're good. You're good. Go ahead.
Eyebrow hair?
No. You're good. You're good.
Barbara has to actually trim those now at my age.
Stay focused on the double D's.
The point is that when you decline to the point that the drama is no longer worth it, you're out of a job. And here's the disconnect that happens. In the NFL, more than in any other sport, we get to know these guys over time. They become characters in our psyches, right? So the disconnect is that there's a disproportional amount of media coverage for a guy like Dez Bryant compared to his actual quality as a player. Remember when I said Adrian Peterson is just a guy?
Yeah.
And he signed with Washington, and good for him, and we're going to talk about him later in the show. But Adrian Peterson doesn't exist anymore. He may still have his heart.
Oh.
But that's not Adrian Peterson.
Yeah.
When you say Adrian Peterson, you think about a guy in the argument as the greatest running back who ever lived, as the best who ever did it. That's not this guy. I used to talk about this on the radio in L.A., Stephen A.
Okay.
Even before Kobe's injury that changed him forever. That was really the end of the Kobe Bryant we all knew, right? But even before that, I would tell people in L.A., guys, this ain't Kobe anymore. This guy who's averaging 26 points and has that kind of old man crazy YMCA game, right? That's not Kobe. It's an old man version of him. He's still as good or better than even an elite scorer at the time like Carmelo Anthony. He's still among the elite players in the league, but that doesn't mean that's Kobe Bryant. What beats in his chest still is, his mentality still is, but he's no longer. So Dez Bryant no longer exists. He is not a number one receiver. He may not be a number two receiver. but he's a name we know and talk about. That's why he doesn't have a job.
But this is why I feel the need to get on you so often when we're talking about the throes of competition. I think you tend to lean on individuals as if they're in a vacuum. You're not taking into account the competition or the supporting cast, assuming they're on the same team.